Hey there, today I'm going to talk about probes, probing, the different types and all that kind of stuff. Now, before I had done two different probe videos for my old monster mill, and I had added a relay in there so that I could change between a normally open and normally closed, and that had all kinds of issues and created noise. Then I went through the trouble of programming a microprocessor and having it be able to invert the signal and all that kind of stuff. It's overkill. You don't have to do that, I found out. If you do anything at all, you might put some debounce on the signal, but even that can be taken care of in software. So let's discuss probes and probing. This is a probe, and internally it's got some little rods that sit and make contact. And whenever this thing gets bumped, one or more of the rods will break contact. But if this thing comes down and you've got a piece of material, you can go like this and you can find the edges. It can come down this way. It can detect anything that makes it break contact, and it can detect. So it's useful for finding the center of holes and all kinds of other things. All right. A lot of times you don't need that. A lot of times what you want is you simply want to measure the length of a tool bit or something. So for that, you've just got some kind of a puck in its simplest form. You've got an alligator clip. You clip it to your tool. Your tool comes down, and when it makes electrical contact, that reads it. That's the simplest form. No, nothing fancy to it at all. Okay? We're going to discuss those, and we're going to discuss the differences in your probing routines so you don't need to make a switch to switch back and forth or any fancy inverters or custom components in the probe or anything else. This doesn't take any power. It's just two contacts, that's it. And when the contacts open in this one, it reads them. And in the case of this, when the contacts close, it reads them. And we'll cover all that in just a minute.
Okay, so we're going to open up step config and tell it to create a new configuration. Alright, the reason I'm doing that is I pretty much just want something that I can jump in and show you the probe settings for. I'm not going to make a launcher or anything because it's only going to be a temporary file. So we'll just leave it default, my mill. We'll go down and change it to millimeter, although I don't even know why. Leave everything else alone. And the only thing I care about, I don't care about any of the outputs, just the inputs, number 15. And we'll set it to be probe in. And there it is. Alright, now if you noticed over to the right, it's not inverted. We just want to leave it plain, just the way it is. And I'm just going to skip through everything else here. I don't really care. I just want to get to a file. Okay, we're going to go in here to show how configuration. It's going to open up this window, and I'm interested in signals. So we'll expand that, and we'll go down and we'll look for the probe in. There it is. And you see it's tied to a port, and if we look at it, it's tied to port 15, which is what we would expect. Okay? So that's good. Now what we'll do is we'll switch to watch mode, and we'll pick that probe input. There it is. And you'll notice that it is yellow. That means it's in the active condition. Now I've got a push button here, and if I click this push button, you'll see a change, okay? You see it? How I can make it turn brown? That would be the deactivated condition.
So you can see this is a screen we were just looking at. And over here, I've got a button to simulate a probe, and I've got my breakout boards here, and this is my developmental machine. So you can see here that when I push this button, we're getting the change state. And right now, with nothing on the button, it shows up as a closed contact. That's because of the way the probe is configured. And I'm going to show you that we don't need to change the configuration or put a reversing switch or any of that stuff in there. So as you can see, I'm coming to you live from
another hotel room. Okay, using probe routines in Linux CNC, we're going to go through how to configure for both probes and touchpads. So let's get started. Now, when you plug a regular probe into the machine, that's the one that has a little thing that comes down that you can bump into, the probe status bit is off. Internally, you've got the little balls and you've got the rod resting up against there, and it's making contact. There's three of them. All three of them are making contact, so you basically have a dead short to ground. And that's considered the deactivated condition. Because of the way probes are designed, they made the probe routines internally to sense a close contact as deactivated. So what happens is when one or more of the switches opens, because the probe has now contacted something, it will show status bit active. Hey, I'm touching something. I'm here. So think about that. Closed is deactivated. Touching is activated. All right, that's how a regular probe is wired up. So G38.2 is our command. It says, I want you to probe until you hit something, or hit something or whatever. If it hits something, it's going to break a contact. That's what we're going to get. Okay, and it's going to be happy. The status is going to change. Now, the G38.2, if it doesn't go, let's say you're so far away from the thing and you tell it to move a certain distance and it goes like this, but it never makes contact, it's going to stop the program and it's going to say, I've got an error. Okay? That can be very useful. Keep you from crashing your machine or running into errors. Now, to use this command, we go G38.2. And then you've got some axis. If I wanted to, I could move the x-axis or the y-axis or the z-axis. So since we're going to be discussing a touch plate, which moves vertically, we'll use the z-axis for all of them, just to keep the information simple here. So in this case, we're telling it z minus 10. So we're telling it, from where you're at, go down 10 millimeters, and if you contact something, stop the program and go about your business and do the next command. If you don't hit it, stop the program. We've got an error and we've got to fix something. Now I'm saying 10 millimeters, but the truth of the matter is, if you're in G20 mode, which is inches, that would be 10 inches. So it's going to depend on whether you're using G20 or G21. Okay? For our discussions, I'm going to say millimeters because I work in millimeters more than I work in inches. Now let's look at the touch plate. For one, you should notice that the ground and the probe input are now switched. The touch plate is connected to the probe input, and we've got a ground clip that clips onto the tool. All right, and in this case, it's the opposite. When we're not touching, it's considered active. When we touch and make the contact all the way around, that's considered deactivated. And so people, myself included, were putting a switch in to flip the signals around, or when they take their probes, they're putting a little electronic circuit in there to switch it. You don't need to do that. I'll show you. So when this comes down, it makes contact, and now it says it's deactivated. All right, when it's up, it's activated. When it moves down, it's deactivated. Okay, up is active. Guess what? We use a slightly different routine. We use a G38.4. Last time we used the .2, probe until closed. This one is probe until open. It works exactly the same way, except a different status. Didn't have to change any electronics. Okay, so this time we just tell it, hey, go until you get the open signal, then stop. If you never make contact, then signal me an error and stop the works. The routine, it works the same way. It touches, boom, it's deactivated. The routine is happy. And in our code, we would just put G38.4. We're going to use Z here. We're going to tell it some distance we want to travel, say 10 millimeters. And again, that depends on whether you're using G20 or G21. Presumably, we'll be doing the G20. So we'll go down 10 millimeters and make the contact. It'll be happy. Now, let's look at the G-code probe commands, all right? The first one we did was the G38.2, probe towards a piece, stop on contact. If you never make contact, give me an error. We pretty much understand that one. G38.3 is the same thing except no error. And why would you use that? Well, say you have a machine and it's got 4 inches of throw total, okay? And we are, you know, up a couple of inches and we tell it to move down 4 inches. It's going to go, sorry, I can't go that far. But, you know, we don't know how high we are above the surface. So we can tell it, okay, we'll go an inch or go 10 millimeters or whatever. And it doesn't make contact, but it doesn't stop the command. So we tell it, do it again, 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 until it does make contact. And we can put some if-then statements in there. So that can be useful. I don't typically use it. I typically write my routines where I know pretty much where I'm at. So I'll bring it down close and then go and probe in. But you've got options. It depends on how you want to write your codes. Then there's G38.4, the exact opposite of the G38.2. It's going to move until it loses contact. For a regular probe or for our touch probe, it'll measure it as lost contact. Still no fancy electronics or anything, and it's not that difficult to wrap your mind around. It's just an opposite state. And then we've got G38.5, which works the same way as the G38.3, except no error signal, and the contact is different. Now, if you look closely, the 38.2 and the 38.3 say probe toward the workpiece, and the G38.4 and the G38.5 say probe away. That's written for your regular conventional probe, where you would go like this and you would hit, and you could back off some distance until you didn't hit, come in slower, and go like this. I used to do that, I don't anymore. Now what I do is, if I hit, I just tell it to come back some known distance and then go back in. And I'll show you that pretty quick here. This is my probe routine. It's for the touch plate. When I come down and I put a new tool in there, I lay the thing on there. It goes like this. It comes up a little bit. I take the thing out. And when I tell it to zero, it goes exactly perfect. And this is my secret sauce. So there's not much to it. It looks complicated, but it's not really, and we'll go through it. The first line is an O. That's not a zero. It's an O. For some reason, Linux CNC decided to start subroutines with O. I don't know why they didn't use S or something, but it's O. Touch to zero is the name of this routine, and it says sub. That's telling the machine this is the start of a subroutine. Go all the way to the bottom. You've got O, touch to zero, and sub. So that defines the start and the stop of the subroutine. So now everything in between there is the routine itself. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to put it in relative mode G21 for metric. And you might be saying, okay, what is this relative mode and absolute mode? If we have a machine that can go from here, 0, to here, 300, and we tell it to go to position 200, it's going to shoot over here to this position. And if we tell it to go from here to 250, it's going to shoot over here. In relative mode, if I'm someplace here and I don't know where I am, but I tell it to go 50, it's going to go from 50 from where it is. And I could do 50 again, it'll go from where it is, and so forth. And in a touch, that's more appropriate because you don't know where you're at. You're going to move incrementally until you hit something. All right? So we're going to tell it in, we're going to tell it relative mode, and then the second line here, G38.4, go until the contact opens, or the thing thinks the contact opens, which you'll be actually touching. I know, it'll mess with your head, but you'll get used to it. Z20, so we're going to probe down up to 20 millimeters, and when the thing hits like that, the Linux CNC is going to read it as an open contact, okay? We're going to feed at 100 millimeters per minute, which means we're going to come in pretty quick, but not quick enough to smash anything. The next thing that I'm going to do is G0, Z1. So we've hit. Now what I'm going to do is pop up 1 millimeter, just enough to break contact. Then I'm going to come down at 1/10 the speed. So I'm going to come down nice and slow and barely make contact. Now I know I'm just touching the surface. The next thing I'm doing is a G10L20. And what that says is where you're at now, we're going to set the reference to be zero at that point, plus any modifications that we might make. So G10L20, P1. There's different pallet positions. G53 is the machine's internal reference. The G54, also known as pallet 1, is where we're going to be setting all our settings 99% of the time. And then what we're going to do is we're saying Z8.650. Why didn't we say 0? Well, I've got a touch plate, and my little homemade touch plate has some thickness in it. And so with the tool sitting on the top of my touch plate, it's not sitting on the bottom. And so my touch plate is 8.650 millimeters tall. So by telling it you are at 8.650, when I pull it out and tell it to go to zero, it will go exactly where it needs to be. Okay? The next command says, hey, get back into absolute mode. Make sure you're in metric. And the next command says, move up 10 millimeters. Why? Why 10? Well, if my touch plate is 8-point-something millimeters, I'm going to pull on it, I'm going to scratch it up. So I tell it go up 10, which is just a little bit above the surface, so I can get my touch plate out of there, and then I can tell it go down the ground or go, you know, do your milling routine or whatever, and it's very happy. So my homemade touch plate is measured as 8.650 millimeter tall. That's mine. When you make yours, whatever the thickness is, measure it and put that number in there, okay? When the mill touches the top of the pad, it's not at zero, it's too tall. We compensate it. We tell it, hey, you're 8.650 too tall. It knows where the bottom is. We move up, take the probe out, and everything is great. That's the touch probe routine. And once you play around with that and you get used to it, you can do a lot more. In the next video, we'll cover some of that. But for right now, this is enough to get us started. In the next video, we'll do active labs where the routine will be demonstrated and verified. We'll have a discussion about how to write your own routines to get the most out of your probes. So make sure you watch that one when I get it posted. And thanks for watching. If you like the videos, please subscribe. Thank you.